and then my colleagues. Today's topic is very interesting and important for us. And this is regarding the fluid management in the emergency room. Most of the people, most of us, we only know how to start the fluids and all that. But what type of fluid and when to start is really a thing that is to be learned by all, because appropriate is very much indicative in some instances and many instances also. So today we have with us Dr. Kiran Kumar Verma, K. He did his MBBS MD and MEM course and DEM course and MHA. And he is working in Yashoda Hospital, Malakpeta branch. And then regarding his, I mean, his educational qualification, I'll briefly mention, he did his MBBS from Narayana Medical College under Dr. NTR Health University, Andhra Pradesh, and did an MD from Vinayaka Mission University, Salem, MEM, Master in Emergency Medicine under Society of Emergency Medicine, India, and Diploma in Emergency Medicine, UK, and Diploma in Fellowship in Diabetology, Fellow, and American Heart Association Instructor, the ACLS Instructor also. So he is now presently working as Program Director in SR Hospital for ER students. And his achievements are also his best young presenter award for American College of Emergency Physicians at PACE 2014 Chennai. And he has got distinguished many awards. It is a big list. I think if I go on reading, I think it will take another 15, 20 minutes. I think his valuable time and our valuable time is more directed towards the students to get their benefits from this talk. So straight away, I request Dr. Kiran to go ahead with this talk on fluid management in emergency room. One request to all the listeners is, please do not create any disturbance by not muting the sound system. Please do listen. And at the end, if you got any questions or any clarification or contribution, you are most welcome. Now I request Dr. Kiran, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Balasa, for your introduction. So now, without wasting our much time, so you go to the topic.
Daddy?
What's he?
Hello. Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yeah.
So, good afternoon, all. So, myself, Dr. Kiran Verma, working as consultant emergency physician at Yashoda Hospital, Malakpet. So, today we are going to discuss about fluid management in ED. So, it is the vital part when you are treating any of the patient, either it may be a trauma patient, burns patient, or sepsis, whatever it is. For each and every patient who entered the emergency department, then who was admitted to IC critical care wards, they require fluids. But so we have a lot of confusion, which fluid to be started, what to be given, what not to begin. If at all you want to start the fluids, how many ml to be given, say that is 20 ml, 30 ml, it depends on patient condition, right? So all the doubts will be clarified by the end of this session, okay? So fluid management, so in our, when it comes to our emergency departments, we treat all trauma patients, burns patients, sepsis patients, where fluid is the mainstay of treatment. Yeah, this is, as you're seeing, this is the trauma chain of survival, first and bystander, first aid, emergency dispatch, all these things. But as a part of chain of survival, early resuscitation plays a vital role, especially fluid therapy, okay? Then just a brief about water content in our body. Why should we know all these things? So when it comes to infant, 70 to 80% of the body occupied the water. Then when it comes to the adult, 60% of the body weight. When it comes to elderly people, it's about 45 to 55%. Yeah, why there is a variation of body? Especially elderly people, they have lower percent of total body fluid than the younger people. Then when it comes to women, so they have lower percentage of total body fluid than the men. So what do you think? So what might be the reason? Simple. muscle tissue has more histo content than the adipose tissue. That's why elderly people have lower percentage of total body fluids than similarly women people. So elderly people have their muscle loss. Women have most of them adipose tissue when compared to the muscle content. Then body fluids. See, water is most important nutrient for life. It is water is primary body fluids. It's in adults, it weighs about 55% to 60% of the water. Then if we lose the water, what will happen? If you lose less than 10% of body fluid, yes, we lost about 80% of the body weight. It is a serious. Then if you lose 20% of the body fluids, we reduce weight about 15%. It is fatal. So every time the fluid, what we are gaining, it should be matched to the fluid lost each day. Then what are the functions of body fluids? It's mainly for the medium transport. It's needed for cellular metabolism, solvent for electrolytes and other constituents. It helps maintain the body temperature. It helps in digestion and elimination of toxic, act as a lubricant as well. Then is the fluid gain and loss mechanism. So it's a gain and loss mechanism. Fluid as a part of gain, fluid intake, we gain about 1500 ml of fluid. Then by food, 1000 ml. Then oxidation of nutrients about 300 ml. Then when it comes to the loss, it's like a sensible loss and insensible loss. Sensible loss, what we see. Insensible, it is not visible. When it comes to sensible loss, urine about 1500 ml, sweat about 100 ml. Insensible loss, by skin evaporation 500 ml, lungs 400 ml and feces 200 ml. Always should be matched. What we are going to gain should be matched with what we are going to lose. Then how we are going to regulate fluids in our body? It's mainly by the hypothalamus, pituitary. Hypothalamus, there are the osmoreceptors which continuously monitor the serum osmolality. If it rises, thirst mechanism get triggered. Then it comes to the pituitary gland. Pituitary gland releases ADH in response to the increased serum osmolality, which causes retention of the fluid from the renal tubules. Then renal part. So when nephron receptors sense the decreased pressure in the, low osmolality, then kidney secretes renins. Renin converts the angiotensin 1, it leads to renin angiotensin 2. Angiotensin causes sodium and water retention by kidneys. Then another part is adrenal cortex. It secretes aldosterone, which causes kidney to excrete potassium and retain sodium and water. So hypothalamus, pituitary, renal, and adrenal cortex. So when it comes to body fluids, it will be divided into two parts, intracellular and extracellular. Intracellular means within the cell, extracellular outside the cell. So intracellular fluid occupies 2/3 of the body fluid. Okay, extracellular, it comprises of 1/3 of the body fluids. Extracellular fluid again divides into three types. One is interstitial, which means that which is around or between the cells. Intravascular, is in the plasma, fluid in the blood vessels. Third part is transcellular. It's like a CSF, synovial fluid, etc. Then, as we discussed earlier, in infants, especially 60% of water found in ECF, 40% of H2O found in ICF. Then what might this mean in regard to fluid loss for infants? Yes. Because it is very, very much essential to know about all these things. ACF, this is the fluid which comprises of 60% of the total body fluid. These people are more prone to develop fluid loss. Then how am I going to maintain the balance? It's like a completely dynamic process. It's a balance between body fluids and electrolytes. So when there is attraction between ions and water, it causes fluids to move across the membrane and leave their compartments. Then solvent, how it's going to move? So mainly by osmosis. What is the osmosis? Osmosis means shift from the lower concentration to the higher solute concentration to maintain hemostasis. So before we are going to discuss about fluids like hypotonic saline, hypotonic and isotonic saline, we should know something about osmolality. See, this is nothing but concentration of particles in solution. So greater the concentration of a solution, greater the pulling pressure. It means that osmotic pressure. Then what is the normal serum osmolality? It's about, it ranges from 280 to 295 milliosmoles per kg. A solution that has more osmolality than serum osmolality called hypotonic saline. Hypotonic means it is low osmolality when compared to the serum osmolality. Isotonic means that equal osmolality between these two. Then what about hypertonic salines? See, hypertonic saline fluids have higher concentration of particles than intracellular fluids. Higher osmotic pressures shifts the fluid from cells into the ECF. That's why if you place any cells into the hypertonic salines, it will get shrunken. So then, what are the uses of hypertonic salines? It used to temporarily treat the hypovolemia. It expands the vascular volume. Then it normalizes the BP and maintains good urine output. Then hypotonic salines. It has less concentration when compared to the ICF. This low osmotic pressure shifts the fluid from the ECFs into the cells. So if you place any cell into hypotonic saline, what will happen? It will get swollen. So see, everything is very much important when you're talking about hypertonic saline and hypotonic saline, because when you are going to treat any patient, especially head injury patient, please don't use hypotonic saline because it leads to the cerebral edema. It raises the ICP because cells will get swollen. Then isotonic salines. So isotonic fluid have the same concentration of particles, it equals with the ICF. So osmotic pressure is therefore same inside and outside the cell. If you place any cell to isotonic saline, it will not either shrunken or swollen. So these are the isotonic fluids, 0.9% normal saline, the RL and 5D. Then another portion is crystalloids. So crystalloids are lower cost. It usually expands the extracellular fluids and maintains the greater urinary flow and replaces the interstitial fluids and transient, it improves the hemodynamics. Then what is the ratio for blood and crystallized? If you lose 1 liter of blood, how much crystallized to be given? It's always 1:3 ratio. So as per the new ATLS guidelines, 10th edition of ATLS guidelines, any patient with trauma with a hemorrhagic shock, adult initially had to give 1 liter of fluids. As per the old guidelines, 9th edition guidelines, it was like 1 to 2 liters. As per the 10th edition, it's like a 1 liter of fluid. When it comes to pediatrics, 20 ml per kg, if patient is less than 40 kg of weight. So if you see that, this is about crystalloids. If you give any fluid, it reaches the intravascular, in the vascular compartment, it stays very short up in the vascular compartment. Then it leaks into the extracellular fluid. Really, it helps a lot. It treats the cellular rehydration, which is essential part when you're treating any patient with hypotension. Usually, it has to correct the cellular rehydration. Our aim is not only to improve the BP, but also to treat the cellular rehydration. In such a way, crystalloids are very helpful. Then colloids. Colloids is greater cost. It expands only intravascular compartment. It will not cross, it may or may not cross what is vascular membrane, and it will not correct the cellular dehydration because it stays remaining in the vascular compartment only. So if you lose 1 liter of blood, it has to be replaced by 1 liter of colloids, 1:1 ratio. Then osmotic, it causes osmodiuresis. It stays remaining in the vascular compartment more than 2 to 8 hours. It causes less cerebral edema, it leads to coagulopathy, sometimes it causes pulmonary edema. No. See, if you give colloids, it stays remain in the vascular compartment only. It won't go to the extracellular fluid levels. So it won't correct the cellular dehydration. Then it comes to hypertonic saline. It osmolality more than 2400 milliosmoles per liter. When it comes to hypertonic salines, it requires only small volume for registration. It reduces the cerebral edema because cells will get shrunken if you place any cell in the hypertonic salines. There is, what are the contraindications when you are not supposed to use hypertonic saline? One, dehydration, allergic renal failures, cardiogenic shock, DKA, coagulopathies, and active hemorrhages. What are the major disadvantages if you treat with hypertonic saline? See, we used to treat hyponatremia with 3% NS. In such a cases, you have to look for central content demyelination. So that's what itself said, osmotic demyelination syndrome. That word itself has been changed from CPM to the osmotic demyelination. Okay. This is the, if you give hypertonic saline, it stays in the intravascular compartment as well as it pulls the water from the extracellular compartment as well. Then it's all about fluids. Then what are the shocks we are going to see, what we are going to treat? See, any shock, we have to differentiate. Either it is hypovolemic shock or cardiogenic shock, distributive shock, and obstructive shock. So as we know that hemorrhagic shock, narrow pulse pressure, and slowing of external bleeding without intervention. If it is a tension pneumothorax, it's obstructive shock, pericardial tamponade, kind of obstructive shock, myocardial and neurogenic shock. Then how we are going to assess stage of shock? This is as per ATLS 10. Then if you are going to, this is, if you lose, we are going to lose less than 15% of blood volume, it is shock 1, 2, 3, and 4. 15%, 15-30%, and 30-40%, and more than 40%. So in this type 1 shock in heart rate, what will it remains less than 100. If it is type 2, stage 2 shock, more than 100. Then if it goes on heart rate, there will be a tachycardia. And systolic blood pressure, it remains normal if it is shock one, and if it is two, usually systolic blood pressure will be reduced. So like the pulse pressure, capillary refill time, and respiratory tract, CNS. Then mainly treatment, if it is a type shock, class 1 shock, you have to treat with 1 to 2 liters of crystallites and maintenance. So we may or may not require blood products. When it comes to class 2 shock, 2 liters of crystallites and we have to re-evaluate again. Then class 3 and class 4 crystallites along with the blood products. That's why you should know about stage of shock. See, when you are treating a patient with fluids, you have to assess whether patient is responded to the fluids or not. So based on that, we divide the patients into 3. One is fluid responders, like a rapid response and transient responders, no responders. When you target as a rapid response, after giving a fluid, after fluid challenge, that all the vitals returns to the normal. In case of transient responders, there will be a transient improvement in the vitals, but it will return to the previous stage. If it is a no response, yes, it remains abnormal forever. So it means that he is not fluid responder. Then based on that, we can estimate the loss of blood. If it is a rapid responder, we assume that blood loss will be about 10-20%. If it is a transient responder, 20-40%. If it is non-responder, means we assume that it is more than 40%. Then what about fluid need for blood and a need for surgery? In case of rapid responders, type 1 cross-specific, and transient responders, we require only type-specific. If it is non-responder, you have to transfuse the blood immediately. We don't wait for cross matching and typing. Then need for surgery in case of no response, it is high likely, and transient responders less likely. Rapid response may or may not be. See, end of the day, any registration means you have to treat everything. It includes, you have to improve the BP, then you have to improve the oxygen saturation to the tissues. See, one of the end point of registration is DO2. DO2 means oxygen delivered to the tissues. So oxygen delivered to the tissues depends on what? One is cardiac output, another one is CaO2. What is the CaO2? Arterial oxygen saturation. So how much oxygen being delivered to the tissues? It depends on these two. Then again, cardiac output depends on heart rate and stroke volume. Stroke volume depends on preload, contractility, afterload. Then DO2, as I told you, arterial oxygenation concentrations. It depends on hemoglobin, PaO2, and oxygen saturation. So DO2, this is the main focus now. So we are not only going to improve the BP, systolic blood pressure map. At the same time, we have to improve the oxygenation. So if you want to improve the oxygenation, what we need to do, we have to do the blood products, especially RBC. This is the only thing which carries the oxygen. Other things they won't carry. So they will just support the volume, improve the end organ transfusion. It will never improve the oxygen carrying capacity. So the only thing which improves the oxygen carrying capacity is RBC. See, this is a vicious cycle of fluid administration. Yes, there is a patient with hemorrhage who starts with the fluid replacement. It leads to inflammation. It causes tissue leakage. Again, it leads to hypotension. Then again, have to do the fluid. It's a vicious cycle. So you have to treat the patient cautiously. See, any patient who comes to ER with an undifferentiated shock, we follow rush protocol. Like, we are going to assess three things. First one is pump, tank, pipe. So based on that only, we are going to treat. So some patients may or may not require fluids. Some patients may require inotropes. So to know everything, we have to follow the rush protocol. So we are going to evaluate pump, tank, and pipes. So by that, we can differentiate among hypovolemic shock, cardiogenic shock, obstructive shock, and distributive shock. Once you know the reason for the shock, then you treat it. So there are many studies on accuracy of rush protocol. Yes. See, sensitivity, specificity when it comes to hypovolemic shock, cardiogenic shock, and obstructive shock is very high. When it comes to distributive shock and mixture shock, yes. Sensitivity is 60 to 72%, specificity about 98 to 100%. And p-values are very significant. So if you feel that you don't have a cause for shock, please follow rush protocols. Then second thing in treating a hypovolemic patient, as a part of fluid restoration, PLR. What is PLR? Passive leg raising. Is it a treatment? No, it's never been a treatment. It's a diagnostic test to know whether a patient is fluid responder or not. That's called passive leg raising. So always we thought that passive leg raising is a treatment. No, it is not a treatment. Again, I'm telling you, it is just a diagnostic test just to know whether a patient is fluid responder or not. Then you have to raise the leg about 45 degrees. Then you have to wait at least for 30 seconds, but not more than 4 minutes. Then there are many studies on the same passive leg raise test and predicts fluid response in critically ill patients. See, one more thing, there are many surrogates when you are giving fluid challenges. One thing is end-tidal carbon dioxide is better than arterial pressure for predicting volume response by passive leg raise test. So when you're doing the passive leg raise test, you have to look for the end-tidal carbon dioxide. So in the olden days, they used to do arterial pulse pressure by placing arterial cannulas. So this is about permissive hypertension. Any patient with a trauma, then in many of the centers, the patient being rushed with the fluids, they used to give more than 2 liters, 3 liters, 4 liters. If we ask why are you being loaded with the fluids, only answer, as patient BP is 100. 110, 120. Please don't try to improve the BP as we are expecting for normal people. So if you are going to maintain BP about 80 to 100 and MAP about 65, that is enough. So that is a concept called permissive hypertension. Permissive hypertension and the minimal volume restrictions are starting with systolic blood pressure is maintained between 80 to 100. At the same time, you have to control the bleeding. So in the permissive hypertension, there are several studies which are shown survival benefits, but it has got own limitations. Their limitation means safe threshold for systolic blood pressure is unknown. Then maximum safe duration also unknown. Hypotension is unknown. How much you have to maintain? Is it less than 80 or more than less than 90 or less than 100? So exact what is the definition for hypotension is unknown. So you can see there are many publications and researches, RCTs, there are many things. So majority of the studies, they are telling that permissive hypotension is very useful in preventing the coagulopathies, and early post-operative deaths, all these things. Then this is meta-analysis of the studies, few studies. So few of the, one of the study is telling that there is a mortal rate difference statistically significant as per Bigger et al. Then when it comes to Dunham et al, mortal rate difference not statistically significant. Then another study, Dutton et al. So mortality unaffected by the permissive hypertension. So now two schools of thoughts, whether we are going to start the permissive hypertension or not. See, I will tell you as a part. See, one of the studies on permissive hypertension. See, in case of abdominal injury, I mean blunt trauma, especially blunt trauma, you please maintain the permissive hypertension. So where it helps a lot with the patient in such a way that it will reduce the bleeding. Okay, in case of blunt injury abdomen, so you can maintain the permissive hypertensions. So this is permissive hypertension as per the old guidelines. So now you have new concept called damage control restoration. Why it has been evolved over a period of years, that is from the recent years. We are going to treat the patient with the, we are going to do the fluid restoration, but we are forgetting about lethal trait. So what are the lethal traits? What are the components of lethal trait? First one is acidosis, hypothermia, and coagulopathy. This is the lethal trait. If we are not going to address these three components, I mean trait features, we are going to lose the patients. You can see the chart. One is hypothermia, acidosis, and coagulopathy. Coagulopathy due to dilution coagulopathy. So we have been giving the fluids. We have been rushing the fluids to the patient, leads to coagulopathy. Then other side, patient may be oozing, may be bleeding. It leads to consumptive coagulopathy. So hypothermia, acidosis, consumptive coagulopathy. These are the lethal traits. So to address all these things, we have new concept called damage control restoration. This has been mentioned in our recent guidelines of ATLS guidelines, 10th edition. So as I told you, this is the lethal trait. Coagulopathy, acidosis, hypothermia. Damage control restoration, integrates permissive hypertension, hemostatic restoration, and damage control surgery. Coagulopathy is common in patient with hemorrhagic shock. In trauma, patient predicted required massive transfusion and administration of transferrin plasma, pacand PPC, 1:1:1 ratio, which are associated with improved survival. See, as a part of damage control restoration, DCS, damage control surgery, is one component of it. So damage control surgery is a strategy which is aiming at normal physiology rather than anatomical integrity. These are the main elements of DCR. First, circulation and ABS restoration, permissive hypertension, limitation of crystallites with the early use of blood and blood products, and early use of tranexamic acid, and damage control surgery. So to address hypothermia, we are giving 1 liter of warm fluids. Then we address coagulopathy, we are giving about blood products and all. So as a part of damage control restoration, we address everything. It includes acidosis, coagulopathy, and hypothermia. Then it comes to massive transfusion protocol. There are different guidelines. So when it comes to ED, if any patient requiring more than 4 units in the emergency department, we can call it as a multiple transfusion. We are going to activate multiple transfusion protocol. So there are many guidelines. Certain people tell that if you are requiring more than 10 units of PRBC, then you have to activate massive transfusion protocol. So different guidelines are there. Then once you activated multiple transfusion protocol, so we get the blood products. It includes PRBC, platelets, FFP, cryoprecipitates. Then we have to give according to patient weight. Then when you're restating any patient with traumatic brain injury, so what are our goals? One, you have to restate the fluids and keeping certain goals in our mind. One is limiting the bleeding risk. Then you have to maintain the cerebral perfusion pressure. Then in which you have to restoration moderately. You have to give about 500 ml of acetylene fluids. Please, in case of traumatic brain injury, don't allow for permissive hypertension. Always maintain BP above more than 110 so that cerebral perfusion will be maintained. Our target is maintain SBP about more than 110 mmHg. When it comes to penetrating injury, the goals are perfusion of at least brain and heart without increase in bleeding and rapid transfer to tertiary care centers, then minimal fluid restriction. Then what about targets in case of fluid restriction in case of penetrating injury? One thing is restore basal cerebral perfusion and you can maintain the permissive hypertension. You can maintain about BP less than 80 mmHg. Then it comes to blunt injury. What are our goals? Perfusion of vital organs without increasing the bleeding, then minimal fluid restriction. Targets like restore peripheral pulses, then keep systolic artery pressure less than 90 mmHg. So now we know about all these things, how we are going to maintain traumatic brain injury, blunt injury, and penetrating injuries. Only in case of traumatic brain injuries, please don't allow for the permissive hypertension. In other blunt injury or penetrating injuries, you can maintain permissive hypertensions. As till now we discussed about fluid management in trauma. Now we are going to discuss about fluid management in septic shock. So as per Surviving Sepsis Campaign Guidelines 2019, fluid of choice is NS/RL. Then volume 30 ml per kg. Then what are our goals when you are resuscitating patient with sepsis? You have to maintain CVP about between 8 to 12 mmHg, mean arterial pressure about more than 65, urine output 0.5 ml per kg per hour, then supervena cavern, mixed vena saturation about 75, 65 respectively. So this is as per recent guideline, Surviving Sepsis Guideline 2019. Then what about fluid management in burns? See, if it is, it depends on flame or scalded burns or electrical injury. Then about patient age and weight. See, when it comes to flame or scalded burns, adults with elderly people, children more than 40 years old, 2 ml ringer lactate patient body weight and percentage of total body surface. In patients, what is our target? You have to maintain urine about 0.5 ml per kg per hour. So it comes around 30 to 50 ml per hour. If children less than 14 of years of age, 3 ml and patient body weight and percentage of burns. In such patients, you have to give fluid about 1 ml per kg per hour. When it comes to infant, young and children, it's like the 3 ml and body weight and percentage of burns. In such patients also have to maintain urine output about 1 ml per kg hour. When it comes to electric injury, you have to give more fluids. It's about 4 ml and other things same. Then you have to maintain urine output 1 to 1.5 ml per kg per hour or your urine gets clear. So now we know about the fluids. What are the fluids to be given, how to treat trauma patient, how to give fluids in trauma and sepsis and burns patient. So care is not going to end up there. Once you resuscitate, it doesn't mean that you have to end up there itself. Then post-resuscitation fluid management also makes the difference in survival and outcome of the patient. See, then what is the post-resuscitation fluid management? The post-resuscitation phase is the period after coagulopathy is corrected, microcirculatory flow is improved and hemodynamic parameters are stabilized. It means that SBP maintained more than 100 mmHg, MAP more than 65. So this is the stage what you can call the post-resuscitation phase. Okay, in such cases, we should have awareness about ROSC, R-O-S-C. R stands for resuscitation, O stands for organ support, S stands for stabilization, E stands for evaluation, which is essential for timely and appropriate decisions. So maintenance fluid should be given such that they stay in the intravascular compartment for longer periods and to avoid tissue edema. During this phase, crystallizers are used for both supplementing the fluid and for administration of medicines. Then what is the maintenance therapy in adult and pediatrics? Is it remain same or is there any difference? If it is same, then how to calculate maintenance of fluids? Most commonly used formula is 4-to-1 rule, which is used for both and adults and pediatrics. So we thought that the 4-to-1 rule is only for the pediatrics. No, it is for both adults and pediatrics. This is as per our internal emergency medicine Then what is the 4-to-1 rule? As we know that 4 ml per kg for first 10 kg of weight, then 2 ml per kg for next 10 kg, then 1 ml per kg for next other kgs. This is 4-to-1 rule. So 4-to-1 rule is applicable for both pediatric and adults. Now, patient has been registration, have been registered. Then what are the endpoints of registration? What are our goals? What are the endpoints? So if you know the goals, then you will be knowing about endpoints. If you know the endpoint, if you don't have endpoints, then you don't know when to stop, when to minimize the registration. Okay. Then if you don't know about the endpoints of registration, there is no point of it. So what is our first goal? Your first goal is to promote the cardiac output. So what is our endpoint? Cardiac index should be maintained more than 3 liters per minute per meter square. Then MABP more than 65. Then urine output more than 0.5 ml per kg per hour. So next goal is promote oxygen delivery. As I told you earlier, DO2, oxygen delivery to the tissue, it should be more than 500 ml per minute per meter square. Then hemoglobin should be maintained between 7 to 9. If it is cardiac patient, it should be maintained more than 9. And SiO2 more than 90. Then next goal is promote aerobic metabolism. Then what are the endpoints? VO2. Then what is the VO2? So VO2 is maximum rate of oxygen consumption by the tissue. This is VO2. Maximum rate of oxygen consumption maintained by the tissue. It should be more than 100 ml per minute per meter square. Then SVO2. What is SVO2? Mixed venous oxygen saturation. It should be maintained more than 70%. Then serum lactate. Okay, less than 2 ml per within 24 hours. Then next goal is promoting of hemostasis. Then what are the endpoints? INR should be less than 1.5, AP2P should be less than 1.5 control, then platelet count more than 50. Okay. So these are our goals and endpoints of registration. First goal is promote cardiac output, promote oxygen delivery, promote aerobic metabolism, and promoting of hemostasis. So these are the our endpoints of registration. You always keep in the mind, if you don't have endpoints of registration, definitely you don't know where to put an end for pre-registration and all. So till now we discussed about types of fluids, then management of fluids in trauma, burns, and other cases, then endpoints of registration. Being a doctors, being in the medical fraternity, we always fascinated about updates and controversies. Some people call it as updates, some people call it as controversies. Always we have two schools of thoughts. Certain people will tell that these are good. Then other set of people tell that this is bad. So we don't know which is good, which is bad. So that's why we always follow evidence-based medicine. We practice it. Okay. Then first controversy, maybe update. So what hemodynamic monitoring do you routinely use for the management of high risk of surgery patients in regards to the fluid registration and hydration status of the patient? Then first one, this is one of the studies, they're telling that invasive arterial blood pressure. Then another study, blood pressure and urine output and clinical expertise. This is another study which is published in the year of 2011 in the critical care journals. Then another one is CVP, but now we are not using CVPs. Then another controversy, colloid versus crystalloid for fluid restoration in critically ill patients. So there are lots of controversy, there are lots of studies in the same. This is one of the study published in the year of 2000. There are many studies on the same. They conclude that no evidence that resuscitation with colloids reduces the risk of death compared with crystalloids in patients with traumatic injury. It means that there is no difference when it comes to mortality. But as we know that crystalloids will correct the cellular dehydration. It will go to the extracellular compartment. When it comes to colloids, since molecules are large, it won't cross the vascular membrane. It stays remain in the vascular compartment only. So it won't correct the cellular dehydration. If you don't correct the cellular dehydration, so you won't correct the acidosis and all. So one part, component of lethal triad is acidosis. So if you are going to treat patient with colloids, we may or may not correct the acidosis part. That's why in such a way, crystalloids are more helpful. So this is one of the new concept called STO2. What is STO2? Hemoglobin oxygen saturation in microcirculation. See, when you are taking ABC, you are going to measure the oxygen levels in arteries. Then SVO2 and venous saturations. Then what about the hemoglobin saturation in microcirculations? We are not going to measure of STO2 by ABC or VBC or SVO2. This is the recent and one of the new concept which is being evolved over a period of years. See, artery divides into arterioles, then capillaries, venules remains. This is called microcirculation, arterioles, capillaries and venules. So this is the place where oxygen being delivered to the tissues. If you measure proper oxygen saturation where it's being delivered to tissues, it gives you a lot of clue. So that's why this concept has been it's been evolving over a period of years now. See, STO2 measures oxygen saturation in the microcirculation where diffuse to the tissue cells. So moreover, this is a sensitive indicator of tissue perfusion status. So this is the concept which is being evolving nowadays. Then one more concept, base deficit. It's been mentioned in our ATLS guidelines 10th edition as well. So base deficit, if it is between 2 to 5, you can call it as mild deficits, then moderate 6 to 14 and severe more than 14. Worsening base deficits coupled with ongoing blood loss, as we know that. Then when normal base deficit taken, it has an endpoint of restoration. As we discussed about endpoints of restoration is base deficit has to come to the normal levels. So this is one of the studies which is being published in the critical care journals in the year of 2013. See, then base deficits, they talk about base deficits. If you bring the base deficits to normal within 6 hours, then chance of survival is very high. Then this is one more study about lactate clearance. So lactate clearance, if lactate comes to normal within 24 hours, chance of survival is 100%. If clearance is comes to normal within 24 to 48 hours, chance of survival is 78%. If lactate clearance is coming to normal after 48 hours, chance of survival is 14%. So this is one of the recent concepts which is being developed over a period of years. Then lactate clearance is one of the endpoints of registration. This is one of the study which is published in the year of 2013. They are concluding that both initial lactase and lactate clearance at 6 hours independently predicts the death in mortality. Then another study, role of hypertonic cell in neurotrauma. We know that if you use hypertonic cell, what will happen? Cells will get shrunken. So the chance of reducing cerebral edema and it will reduce the ICPs. Then one of the new concept is new generation gelatins. These are low molecular weight, cheaper than albumin and other synthetic colloids. It is rapidly excreted by the kidneys, associated with a less renal impairment than hydroxyethyl starch. It has no upper limit volume that can be infused, unlike starches and dextrons. They have low risk of dilution coagulopathy than dextrons and starches. So then what is the drug? What is the molecule? This is the polyxylin. It has a short life of 4 to 6 hours, readily excreted in the urine. it does not seem to adversely affect the gel function of new gelatins. So now we are going to conclude our session. Thing is, registration should be seems to continue in the pre-hospital care, emergency room, and intensive therapy. Venous access and fluid therapy are necessary part of this continuum, but the optimum timing for fluid administration depends on the circumstances. Patient survival is linked to the overall quality, integration, communication, and process of care in trauma system. Then I'm just going to summarize about. If it is a severe hemorrhagic shock patient, aggressive versus judicious fluid therapy, what to be done? Still it is inconclusive. Then permissive hypotension, we can follow it, provided there is no traumatic brain injury. Then minimal resuscitation, stop the bleeding. First, minimal resuscitation, stop the bleeding, then go for the maximum resuscitation. Then follow the damage control resuscitation. Then fluid of choice is Ringer lactate or NS. Then RBC, if HCT is less than 25, FFP, cryoprecipitate for coagulation problems. If it is a septic shock patient, early goal directed and large volume therapy, choice of fluid is NS and RL. So these are the future trends. As I told you, focus on, venous saturation, mixed venous saturations, and DO2 oxygen derivative tissue, SpO2 monitoring, oxygen saturation at microcirculation level, base deficits and serum lactate as a prognostic markers, hypertonic saline and traumatic brain injury with regard to cerebral edema. Then ultrasound plays major role, like a fast, EFAST and RUSH protocol. Now we are being using FALSE protocol, fluid administration limited by the lung sonography. Then starch as a first choice of fluid in septic shock. Many trials are going on same. Then new generation gelatins. So these are my references. So thank you Anand.
Thank you, Dr. Kiran, for your excellent presentation. This is really informative and useful to the students. And my dear students, at this juncture, I would like to say that we are having regular classes on every Tuesday from 3 to 4 p.m. And this is mainly directed for the students who are appearing for the examination. Useful. We are choosing only those topics which are useful in day-to-day life as well as to appear for the examination. So please do attend in large numbers, and then we will also inform with various modalities, WhatsApp groups and other things also. And interactive session will also be there if you are very much interested. But please do attend so that it will be encouraging for us also to speak. Otherwise, this will our attempt will be a futile attempt. So your attendance will make us to come with new topics. So I think my once again request Dr. Kiran to please answer if there are any questions. And students, please do ask any question or any contribution from your side or doubts. Dr. Kiran is very much there. And within the exactly 40 minutes, 45 minutes, that is the period where any student can imbibe of things. He has chosen the right time and then good topic. I once again thank Dr. Kiran. I request the students, please do post some questions or clarification you require, is ready to answer. Do you have any question in the box, Dr. Kiran?
So there is a question, sir. Can you elaborate about fluid choice and COPD, ischemia, and hemorrhagic CVS? So in fact, there is no specific fluid for COPD and ischemia. Oh, COPD. So you can use NSRRL only as a maintenance fluid of therapy. Then it comes to ischemic and hemorrhagic CVA. It remains same, normal saline, isotaline salines. If patient is having raised CVP, so due to ischemic hemorrhagic CVA, then you have to use the hypertonic salines. So that is the only difference among fluids. When it comes to COPD, there is no specific fluid for COPD.
We actually last week was already Krishnashtami, Ugadi, and then prior to that was the topic on the thesis, how to write thesis. He could only deal half of it. Likely, if the speaker is going to come next week, he will have that topic on the next Tuesday. Otherwise, we will have some other topic. So thesis writing is an important, the clues and the tips that he is going to offer will be useful for us to write the thesis. So again, once again, I request the students to attend to that. Otherwise, if the speaker is not ready next week, the next week will also be given time to him. And however, we have next week another topic, and mostly it's useful for the students both. Thank you. If there are no other questions, we'll wind up with a big thanks to Dr. Kiran once again.
Thank you. Thank you, Balasa. Thank you, Arundal. Thank you, Anbai, for giving me opportunity. Thank you, Arundal.
Thank you.